All right, guys, welcome to a hot afternoon. Decided to bring Pop out of here because he's been cooped up for the past almost, it's gonna be a week tomorrow that he got his spleen out. And 2 days ago, we had an emergency with him. We had to take him to emergency at 3 o'clock in the morning because he was really in pain and he was panting and panting. He's better now. Oh, Papa, I know it's hot. He's got a little patch on his back. Gave him a little sedative there, and he's doing a lot better. But he was doing okay the 2 days following the surgery. But what happened was that my wife gave him a pain pill. And he's got a habit of, you know, he flips it around and spits it. So she gave it to me and she goes, here, put him down his throat because he don't want to take it from me. And I said, okay. So I usually put it on the corner of his mouth and shove it down, and then I started massaging his throat. But in the process of doing that, he bit the pill and the powder came out in his mouth. And eventually he swallowed it with his saliva, and he also swallowed the capsule. And what happened was that the most medicines are designed to be time release, meaning that the capsule will start dissolving and putting out the medicine little by little, and it will last the 6, 7, or the 8 hours it's supposed to last. So being that he bit it, he got a quick dose of that medicine, the painkiller, and by 3 o'clock it wore out because it wasn't being delivered slowly in the capsule. The capsule was ready to rupture and the whole thing. So he was in tremendous pain, and he was scratching the door when I took him inside the bedroom. And the wife went out and took him out to pee pee. Maybe he wanted to do that, but he didn't. Because usually sometimes he does that at 4 o'clock, 5 o'clock in the morning. He wants to go to the yard and pee and let him out. But no, he came to my side and he's pawing the bed, something he's never done. And then he got on two paws on top of the bed, and he, like, telling me, I'm hurting. So I said to her, listen, we got to take him to emergency. Let's see if we can get a mild sedative. So we rushed with him, found a place down in Ontario, and had a consultation with the vet, and he checked him out. He says, well, okay, there's no internal bleeding, because we thought it was that too. There's no internal bleeding, he's fine. But I don't want to give him anything for pain because he already has what he's supposed to take. And I said, okay, so we didn't do anything. He was a little calmer this time. And we decided to go home. And then in the morning, waited for our vet to open his office. And we took him there and checked him out and gave him a little sedative injection, and put a little patch on his back. And that did it. He was calm and he slept. Because he was really tired, he needed to sleep and rest, but he couldn't because of the pain. So once he got back, he got into his bed and he slept like the whole day. He was out, and now he's better. So he's moving around, but it's boring for him because he's just laying around here, laying around there. He had lunch, anyways. And he jumps on the sofa. But before, when he would jump on the sofa, he would go like this because the incision and the staples are here, and that would kind of hurt him a little bit. Yeah, Papa, you're doing good now. So he's a lot better. So now, I let him come out here. He kicks around with me, and he watches me talk to myself. And I said, okay, I'm gonna sit here and have a cup of coffee. Just chat a while, and He's probably not going to be out here too long because it is warm. He hasn't even lied down yet. He usually flops down and there he goes. There he goes. Okay, so now he's resting for a while because it's too hot. He gets up by himself, he goes into the garage, and okay, open the door. I want to go back inside the air conditioning. So I'm gonna smoke my last in, it's a little hard, but it's coming around. The Gloria Cubana Classic. Let's see if it wants to light up. So I was watching some videos last night. Well, let me start at the beginning. Yesterday, I went to the boat with a friend of mine. Because I said, listen, I got to work in the engine and I don't want to be going up and down. It's tiring, you know, and stepping into the hull in there on the floor of the engine, I'm stepping on the hull, which is angled and it's very uncomfortable. By the time I'm finished and I go home, my legs are sore. And I have to build a floor straight. So I want to buy some wood for that. I think there's a board over there that's a 2x6. I want to see if I can get another one. So when I stand in it, I'm level and it doesn't put so much strain because I'm stepping on the bolts coming off the bottom, holding the bracket that holds the shaft, and I'm stepping on all that, and I'm trying to position my feet. Anyways, so I went to the boat with the idea of removing the carburetor and taking it to the shop. Like the guy said, it sounds like you need bigger jets on the carburetor. And I said, okay, that sounds logical. But then I'm in communication with this boat mechanic and YouTube, and he writes to me and he goes, your firing order is not right, that's why you're getting those backfires. So I get to the boat and I had that in mind, and I said, okay, I'm not taking the carburetor off yet, let me check the firing order. And I start checking the firing order, and the engine started, but it was doing the puff, puff, you know. But the engine did start, so I'm checking the firing order with the numbers, and I'm going, oh, there's a couple of numbers here that are wrong. So I kind of switch them around. The engine won't start. I keep switching it around. The engine won't start. I keep moving stuff, and my friend is up there, right? And I say, hit it, and he will try to crank it and crank it, nothing. And I'm spraying carbs, you know, engine start, nothing. It got to the point that at the end of the day, the boat didn't start at all. And I'm going, but why? I'm following the firing order to the key. 127, you know, 127, 5, 6, 3, 4, 8, like that. So anyways, we finished the day. We didn't accomplish, we were only there for about two and a half hours because we went late. Went to visit some people I haven't seen in years, and anyways, so we went to this restaurant, had a couple of beers, and we talked to it. This is a friend of mine from high school. We're chewing the fat and talking about the old days and all this stuff. So I get home and I'm puzzled. I'm looking at the numbers and I'm going, they're in order, they're all in order, how come the engine didn't start? Well, I looked at a video that they don't say anything. It's just a diagram of an engine with the firing order, and it's going, and I'm looking at it and I'm going, wait a minute, The firing order is in order, but it's in the wrong, it's backwards. It's the other way. Because the way I had it on the cap is, it's one, two, no, the two is on this side. So it's one, let me see. Yeah, 127, ta, 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 ta. But I'm doing this, right? Well, the distributor is not turning, even though the engine is a left turning engine, the distributor is turning to the right, not to the left, meaning that the 127 order has to be on this side, not on the opposite side. So right now it's backwards. And I said, shit. So I called my friend at 10 o'clock and I said, I figured out the problem. And he was laughing. So he couldn't make it today. And I was kind of sore and I didn't feel it's too freaking hot to do anything. I said, okay, tomorrow's going to get cooler. I'll go tomorrow. And I don't know if he's going to be able to go with me and help me to finally get that engine running. And then when it runs, I'm going to start tweaking the carburetor. There's an adjustment on the choke. And there's an adjustment on the fuel. And I'm going to do a few things to see if the carburetor stops backfiring. If it doesn't stop backfiring, then I'll take it off. And I'll take it to that shop. Now, and that's the Elderbrook. Now, the Rochester carburetor, I have it here in the garage. I open it up. I open up the filter. Filter is clean. There's nothing in it. So I said, if there's nothing here in the little mesh, it's a stainless steel mesh, really fine filter, there can't be anything in the carburetor. But that carburetor was flooding, so to open it up it's going to be 250. And the idea was to first try the Elderbrook and see if the Elderbrook does the job, and then take it out, run it, and do it. And then if it doesn't, if it needs the jets, then I'll take it off. Eventually, I think that carburetor, being that it's not a marine carburetor, that carburetor is going to end up on the Blazer, because it's going to give power to the Blazer. I'm going to eventually end up rebuilding the Rochester for 250. So some other people quote me 275. Because they're designed to pour more fuel in the engine, because the engine needs, when you give it a load, it doesn't have a transmission, it's just forward gear and reverse, it's gonna need more fuel coming in. And right now, the jets that it has, it's for a regular vehicle, you know, pickup or Blazer or something, a car. So eventually I'm gonna end up doing the Rochester. Man, I felt like an idiot when I noticed what I did, because I'm looking at the firing order. I drew two diagrams of the distributor, the right one and the left one. Now, when I say the right one, I don't mean the position of the engine, because the right turning engine, it's on the left of the boat, looking towards the bow. And the left turning engine is on the right side. In other words, in nautical terms, starboard and port. So the engine that is left turning, it's on the starboard side. I think I got it right. I never got that too straight. And that's the confusing thing. Both engines turn, the distributor turns to the right. So I was looking at the other order. I was looking at the left turning engine firing order numbers, but I applied them like for the right turning engine. And that was the confusing thing. So when I got here and I kind of started looking, and I saw that the little drawing, and I'm going, wait a minute, the thing goes the opposite. So when it's firing, it's not firing 127, it's firing the opposite way. It's gonna be 8, Look, it could be one if you have it right there on the top and center one, and then it goes to eight, and then it goes drrr, because the way it fires, it goes from one to eight, from two to seven, and then three, four, five, six, like that across. So I got it. I finally got it. It's a little bit confusing. If it was a regular training engine, it wouldn't be an issue. It wouldn't be a problem. Live and learn. And I like to learn. Okay. Okay. Thank you, babe. That's very good news. Okay, I had to interrupt because we got some good news that the spleen, they checked it out. They took it to a lab, checked it out, and it was no cancer. So Papa is good to go, no cancer. He's not in danger, and he's recouping. So that was very good news, very good news. She was crying, poor thing. She loves that boy, you know. The guy didn't know the dude. He just felt like doing it. People are losing their minds, and that brings back that video that I saw a long time ago. I'm talking 8, maybe 10 years, that this guy from Central America, this was a Spanish video, he says that he had a vision or a dream, but the way he described it, it sounded like it was more like a vision, that he was in his yard in daytime, and Jesus Christ and two other beings showed up. And told them that in the future, in the near future. All right, guys, I'm gonna sit here and water a little bit. And I'll see you on the next one. I hope everybody's well. Thank you.